I'm Stuart McConey, and thanks for joining me here on The Freak Zone on BBC Six Music, our weekly tour through all that's left field in music, from free jazz to electronica to prog rock to soundtracks to obscurities to psychedelia to whatever we fancy, really. I don't know what you'd describe the music of Jenny Hvale as, but she's a Norwegian artist who makes compelling, often dark records, and her second album has just come out. It's called Blood Bitch. During a break in rehearsals for her forthcoming tour, I caught up with Jenny, and she told me exactly where she was.
Sort of near the centre of Oslo, in the eastern part, yeah. Where they like to put everyone who doesn't really belong in the stylish uptown parts.
Is that right?
So it's a lovely community of all kinds of wild people and artists, and wow. Yeah, everything that people in the rest of my fairly homogenous country don't really see much of.
Let's talk about the new record. Let's talk about Blood Bitch. Is it true to say it's almost a fictionalization of your story? Would that be fair enough to say?
I think you could say that. A reflection of my life in a more sort of collective setting of our times, of being a touring musician, a freelance worker, a child of capitalism,
yeah.
Sort of. And that doesn't sound very exciting, but it's also like an investigation of a very personal relationship I have with sound and to a lot of movies.
Yeah.
And a lot of horror movies in particular, because I really love a lot of sound elements in different types of horror films.
What kind of eras and what kind of movies? I'm thinking, I like you showing interest in that. I'm just wondering, what kind of countries and times are we talking about these movies?
I've been particularly interested in a set of movies made around the Mediterranean, around like mid-70s.
Okay.
Low-budget horror films and exploitation films, yeah. Or like some kind of erotic genre. Yeah. Sometimes a mix, sometimes, you know, you have three different versions of one film, and one is like the sex version and one is the horror version,
yeah.
With more blood. You know, this kind of very surreal and makeshift world. And a particular director called Jess Franco, who made hundreds of films in his lifetime. And these films that I've watched over and over again are very low budget. So it kind of reminds me of a lot of subculture music that I've grown up with and grown to love, and where I also kind of come from.
This blood bitch's tale goes a bit like this. Sentimental for you.
The word blood, I don't think it was there very early on, but it sort of kept sneaking into lyrics.
Yeah.
And it kind of, we made a record as if like having a body, and then we kept cutting into it and more blood sort of came out.
Yeah.
I think it happened because I didn't want to have a finished set of lyrics before I started recording. This time it was like all happening at once. Sometimes I was improvising very embarrassing things in my mind and it's on the album, and we just had to find then a context where this embarrassed voice could exist.
The next time I wake up, there's blood on the bed. Didn't know it was time yet. Or is it not mine?
Your work is political without being necessarily party political, or political with a capital P. And do you think when your work is political, it's a politics that rises from emotion and experience rather than a very didactic lecturing way?
Well, I think that's how I see it.
Yeah.
And I think that I've tried harder with this album to sort of really investigate the emotional relationship I have with sound, and then keep the politics just arising from whatever it is I say. But I'm not sure if that always is how people hear it. And that's probably due to the fact that when there is political sides to art and it kind of gets through the filter of journalism, it tends to be sort of blown up into something very clear. But I love that context when it's still quite mysterious. Because I really believe in music as something emotional and mysterious, as well as having really sort of subversive political potential.
Like capitalism.
Oh. Wow.
It works like unrequited
love. If you don't, maybe I can take it for my friends.
Take it.
It never
ends.
Take it for you and I.
I want one.
Just like I need the love I'm not getting.
The record came together in your head, I guess, when you were touring, but what did you physically record?
It's all recorded here in Oslo.
Okay.
It's a one-room album,
right?
Almost. It's recorded in a sort of bike shed / little house in a backyard.
Right.
I mean, most albums could not have been recorded there unless they're purely electronic. And we just chose to rather than have a studio and, you know, the meter running, which is a horrible feeling for me anyway. Some people probably deal well with it, but we had then a lot of time, and I had a lot of time to think. Not think intellectually so much as have breaks and go touring again and things like that, and then just return and be confronted with what I'd done. Also because the way it's edited together, it sort of narratively comes together, not as a sort of concept album with characters, but more like songs flow into one another, and we have very specific contradictions we would like the album to have, or like interruptions from a real world,
right,
found sounds and my friends talking and things like that.
You're playing in the United States and Canada before you come to the UK, but then you play here October 17th in Glasgow, then the 18th here in Manchester at the Soup Kitchen. When you play these songs live, when you take the album on the road, as they say, how will it work? Who'll be there?
There will be three people on stage, me and a musician doing mostly electronic stuff, and then choreographer and dancer. I'm actually not quite sure how it will be yet,
okay,
because we're quite spontaneous, and I think the music will be slightly more clubby than on the album.
Right.
And I don't know if there'll be a lot of dance, even though I'll have a choreographer and dancer on stage, but there'll be sequences, I think, where we can move a bit. For the last few shows, that has meant things like someone cuts my hair on stage.
Yeah.
But yeah, I try not to get the feeling that I have to do something inventive in a sort of thing that looks good on Instagram, you know?
Yes.
Sometimes it's really good to just stand there also and do something that doesn't fit on the internet.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I guess, yeah, I kind of love that. So maybe a bit of both.
Well, whatever form it takes, we look forward to seeing you when you get over here. And thank you very much, Jenny.
Thank you.
And I've never known pleasure like this.